Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to the study of antiquity and the Middle Ages. As always, I am your host, Nick Barksdale, and today we are joined once again by Dr. Rebecca Futo Kennedy. And now we're coming to a modern argument that many people, if you're on a variety of history platforms online, you're going to be familiar with some really intense debates, usually between modern Greeks and Macedonians on ancient history. And so this episode is going to be titled Macedonians versus Greeks and the Battle for Ancient History. And so not only are we going to approach this modern Greek versus modern Macedonians and their tensions, but this is going to be more about a subject that they're arguing about, and that is whether or not the ancient Macedonians were Greeks. And Dr. Kennedy, I was hoping that from an outside perspective, if you could guide us into what this debate is, the tensions that it derives from, and really just give us a brief overview of this subject.
Yeah, so this one's a little crazy. As someone who spends time in Greece fairly regularly, you can see it on the ground at times. But so the debate goes back to antiquity. The modern debate is really over whether or not this entity that used to be part of Yugoslavia can name itself Macedonia or the Republic of Macedon. And because, of course, the northern part of Greece today, which encompasses Pella and what had been the ancient part of the ancient region, is the province of Macedonia. And so there are tensions over between Greek nationalists and these Macedonian nationalists or Macedon nationalists, whatever you want to call them, over whether or not you're going to allow this republic to exist. And if it does come into existence, will they then try to lay claim to northern Greece as if by laying claim to that name, they lay claim to this? And so for like 27 years or something like this, this name had been disputed and debated in UN, whether or not this was going to happen, and Greece wasn't going to let it happen, and they kept blocking it. About 2 years ago, I think it was, it came to a head. This is actually, I was touring all over Greece to archaeological sites all over Greece at the time, and every sort of small village in the north, when I was up in, you know, up in Pella and up in Thessaloniki and sort of up in the province of Macedonia, where you would go into these small villages and there were little stages set up in the middle of town because there either had been or was coming soon a rally for Macedon is Greece, right? This was the movement. You see it spray painted all over Greece in tunnels and places, just Macedon is Greece. And one of the funnier things as part of this debate was that the mayor of Athens, of all places, had a statue put up, and I'll share a picture with Nick, you so you can actually like put this image up so people can see. It's the 20th century sculptor Yannis Pappas. This sculpture was unveiled April of 2019. This sculpture that he had done of Alexander on a horse was put up in the middle of Athens. Now, if you're an ancient Greek, you're an ancient Athenian, the idea of having a statue of Alexander, which we know there were like dozens and dozens of sculptures of Alexandria in Athens, but he was considered an outsider conqueror and a bad guy, not somebody you wanted to lay claim to. This is like a sort of amazingly ironic move, but this was part of this modern debate over whether or not Macedon, this name can be used for this republic made up of the of former Yugoslavia. The question is, of course, that sculpture, silly sculpture aside, and you know how much we know that the Athenians disliked them, like, well, they're split, right? Some people were in Philip's pay and some people were sort of anti-Philip, but then none of them really liked Alexander. The moment Alexander turned his back, the Athenians were like, woohoo, we're free. And they had to be, you know, continually monitored. But our ancient sources, going back to our earliest sources that talk about this debate, which is Herodotus, of course, because he talks about all this stuff, it's really unclear. The ancient Greeks themselves were not clear about whether or not you want to consider the ancient Macedonians Greeks or not. Lots of our ancient texts say they were. And I believe it was the former retired Berkeley archaeologist, Stephen Miller, who's the director of Nemea, he compiled a website of sources to show that Macedonia is Greece. Macedonians are Greeks. And he ran a letter writing campaign about this under the Obama administration. But there are equally as many texts that say Macedonians weren't Greeks. So, for example, they were turned away, according to Herodotus, I believe it's book 5, They were turned away from the Olympic Games to compete. The king of Macedon was turned away until he was able to prove that he had a descendant who was from Argos. And then he was allowed to compete in the Olympic Games. Yes, they spoke the Greek language, but we see people making fun of their dialect. Aristotle, of course, yes, he lives in Athens, but he is driven out of Athens over and over again because of his pro-Macedonian sentiments. Macedonia was considered a threat until, of course, we get to the 4th century, and then they are, Philip, who's able to sort of solidify his power, is actually able to assert his Greekness through his military power and also through religious rituals, right? So he's the guy who helps defend the Olympic Games and the Eleans and their control of the Olympic Games. He helps protect Greek sanctuaries, and so this allows him to get the status of Greece as Greek. So we start seeing, starting in the 4th century, we see a lot more sources that are like, yes, Macedonians are Greeks. Of course they're Greeks. But our 5th century sources and earlier are not as clear on it. And then, of course, we have the problem of Alexander himself and all of our texts about Alexander, which root back to the writers who were with Alexander, his own generals. They keep Greeks and Macedonians distinct when they're talking about military units and when they are talking about people. They talk about the Macedonians and they talk about the Greeks. And these are Macedonians mostly doing this writing, or people who are followers of Alexander and his generals and his poets and people who write for him. So did the Macedonians think of themselves as Greeks? Sure, you know, but also not. It's the same problem of Athenians versus Spartans versus Macedonians. But when you put Hellenes in one category and Macedonians in another category in your own military histories, and you don't let the military units mesh, et cetera, that's a question that is, it raises a question. And then, of course, we have the problem of Alexander himself, who is Macedonian. He views himself as Macedonian, but of course, his Macedonian generals all get mad at him because he's starting to become a barbarian, because he starts adopting Persian practices and starts, you know, making marriages between his Macedonian soldiers and local peoples. Note, not his Greeks. He sends the Greeks home. It's the Macedonians who do this. And then he starts raising an army of children who are from these mixed marriages, etc. So, and then of course, when we get into the Hellenistic period, the Seleucids and others, are they still Macedonians? Are they Greeks? Are they Syrians? Like, what are they? Who are they? It's unclear. Same thing with the Ptolemies in Egypt. Everybody wants to debate. They're Macedonian Greeks, or they're Macedonians, or they're Greeks, but they're marrying into the Seleucid clan family. You know, they've got Syrians, they've got all this stuff. I don't think they thought about these categories as strictly as we do after the 5th century, which seems to be when the Greeks are most obsessed with their individual identities. And the way that they're talked about in the 5th century texts, they're borderline Greeks. They're not very much more Greek than Thracians are, but you can intermarry with Thracians just as you can intermarry with Macedonians. Lots of Athenians marrying with Thracian princesses. That's how you get your money and your gold mines. But in the 4th century, they become Greeks. But we then see this trend of them always being sort of separated and kept distinct from the Greeks in our sources. Potentially because these are sources that are Macedonian originally, and they think they're better than all the other Greeks, just like the Athenians think they're better than all the other Greeks. And so maybe it's simply a matter of that sort of chauvinism. But I don't think that it's clear. If we go on linguistic grounds only, yes, they're Greeks. If we don't go on linguistic grounds and we go on what they actually sort of, how they identified and built their cultures, it's not as clear. And there's a whole lot of history between Alexander, when this identities seem to matter, and the modern debates that what's happened in between, you know, in the, all the centuries and the millennia in between, under the Ottomans, you know, under the Soviet Union, right, as Yugoslavia, what does it all mean? So I think the answer to this question of whether Macedonians are Greeks is one that we, in fact, will never answer definitively. I don't think that in antiquity it's an easy question to answer, and I don't really know how relevant it is to this modern debate of whether or not you can prove that Philip was treated as a Greek by other Greeks, if that makes that becomes the answer to the modern question of whether or not the Republic of Macedon can call itself the Republic of Macedon, and whether that means that northern Greece is going to be attacked or detached from the rest of Greece. That's a problem of nationalism and modern nationalism, and the fact that the Balkans and the Black Sea regions, and that these are hotbeds of ethnic dispute and of nationalistic movements. As long as those nationalistic movements exist, we're going to have that tension, but that the question isn't answerable by antiquity.